Well, good morning, everyone. Before I get started, as Jim noted, we have an excellent awards program. The award I'm presenting today is just one of several awards that ASLO has. So I urge you to go to our website and look at the awards descriptions and think about who of your colleagues, mentors, or mentees you can nominate for our awards. We receive applications each year and make decisions in the fall. All right, so today it's my pleasure to introduce the recipient of the 2016 G. Evelyn Hutchinson Award, Dr. Jack Middleburg of Utrecht University. The Hutchinson Award is one of ASLO's most prestigious awards, and it's given each year to a scientist who's made exceptional contributions to limnology or oceanography by the middle stages of their career and shows promise for continued scientific excellence into the future. So Jack is being honored with this year's award for his pivotal contribution to the development of concepts and models incorporating the role of aquatic biota in carbon and nutrient cycling in aquatic ecosystems. And Jack is really a unique and very fitting recipient of this award in that his work covers nearly the entire range of aquatic sciences. He works in freshwater and marine environments on a range of organisms, including benthic animals, bacteria, and algae, and his studies cover the scales from nanoscale all the way to global scales. He takes an interdisciplinary approach to all his research by integrating observational and experimental process-based studies with modeling to gain new insights into aquatic ecosystem function. And Jack is certainly internationally recognized and has an outstanding publication record. Which is an evidence of his productivity and high impact in the field. To date, he has over 290 publications, with 85 of those in the last 5 years alone, and over 13,000 citations. And among the many accolades he's already received, he's an elected member of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences. So his first major contribution grew out of his PhD work in geochemistry at Utrecht University, when he published a single-author paper in 1989 in which he introduced the reactivity continuum concept for organic matter decomposition to marine sediments. And in subsequent work, he and colleagues further developed this idea to present a quantitative continuous measure of organic matter quality. And these ideas have really stood the test of time and are widely adopted across the aquatic sciences today. He's also pioneered the use of stable isotopes in combination with compound-specific biomarkers to trace the flow of carbon and nitrogen through entire food webs and through entire aquatic systems. And most recently, he published a very comprehensive review paper on the use of stable isotopes to study aquatic food webs. He's been a leader in the development of generic sediment biogeochemical models for the use of, one example is to scale up benthic processes to make global estimates of carbon and nitrogen cycling in sediments. And that he developed this for marine sediments, but it's been applied to all different types of aquatic systems. And some of his most recent research includes the study of impacts of ocean acidification and hypoxia on marine ecosystem function. And in addition to the stellar record, scientific record that Jack has, he also he's very generous with his time and makes it a priority to mentor students, to collaborate in large group efforts for research, and is active in scientific societies, in communities, and serves on the editorial board of several journals. So please join me in congratulating Jack Middleburg for the 2016 G. Evelyn Hutchinson Award.
Thank you, Kim. Please take a second. Good morning. I would thanking Kim for the very nice words. I'm really a little bit emotional about it. So I would like to start then also thanking those colleagues, friends, and who have nominated me, who have taken time to write support letters. Also lots of my my cooperators, which have inspired me to do the research which I did. So I would like now to immediately start with the talk. So my talk is about the processes happening at the seafloor. So I'm going to the bottom of seafloor ecosystems. So here you see a picture of how I look at the ocean. I consider the processes happening in the water column of similar importance as those in the sediments. It really depends on your perception where you think are the most important processes happening. So this picture shows that and besides the photosynthesis in the surface layer, the export of organic matter, where we do lots of studies, it ultimately a small fraction arrives at the seafloor. And at the seafloor, this organic matter is being processed by a rather complex community of organisms. The net result is that a small fraction is being preserved, is being buried. The majority is respired to CO2 by all the organisms involved. And one of the questions is, what's the role of all those organisms? Do we have to know the identity of those organisms in order to understand what's happening at the seafloor? Now, I'm trained as a geoscientist, and when I started to work at the Netherlands Institute of Ecology, now the Netherlands Institute of Sea Research, I came in contact with a lot of biologists, and we could really see that there were differences of approaches. The seafloor for biogeochemists, as you can see on this picture, is basically there is carbon coming to the sediment floor, part of it is buried, the majority, 90%, is recycled, and it is really a black box. What is the vision of geosciences for organic matter processing in sediments? Basically, you have carbon input, you have a black box where things are happening. A small part of the organic matter which is coming in is eventually buried, and the majority is respired. And the black box, the only thing you want to really want to know as a geoscientist is how much delay is there. If I drop organic matter to the floor, is it immediately turned into CO2? Does it take a week, a month, or a year, or 1,000 years? So the buried organic matter, that's what geologists are interested for their paleo reconstructions. If you want to understand the redox balance of the ocean, that's where you're going to look at. If you are more in a biogeochemist, you are looking at the recycling of organic matter because you're looking at nutrient regeneration, the release of phosphate, nitrate, ammonium, alkalinity, which keeps on going the whole biogeochemical cycle. And the delay, which how geoscientists look at it, is a property of the organic matter. There is no role for organisms. Organisms are just there like a chemist sees a catalyst. Just they speed up the processes, they do the things which thermodynamics would predict should happen. And the identity of the organism is not an issue. So based on those concepts of geosciences, a number of groups in the beginning of the 90s made simple models which were making a major step forward because they could predict the things happening in sediments. Before that, it was really observational and anecdotal observations here and there. And at that time, there were a few groups which, at about the same time, they went to make mathematical models which were rather simple, but nevertheless could reproduce the observation. As you can see here, these are observations in the deep Pacific. There were measurements of the organic carbon rate, the solid line. There were observations of the oxygen consumption at the seafloor, that's the squares. And then the model predicted, this is not model fitting, they were using generic constants, could reasonably reproduce the observations. And the model could also produce the pore water profiles, the effluxes of nitrate, ammonia, etc. So this was a major step forward, and I did this together with Carleen Soutat and Peter Herman, and the conclusion from this type of sediment biogeochemistry models was really like, there are lots of parameters which you can study. There's a whole literature about it, but only five really do matter. The first thing is, what's the organic carbon flux to the sediments? If you know that, you can pretty much predict what's going to happen. The second most important thing is the reactivity or the lability of the organic matter. Basically, how fast does it react? The third factor which is important is the oxygen concentration. And the fourth and the fifth have to do with animals. That's particle mixing by the animals, called bioturbation, and bioirrigation, that's solute mixing. So what we have five things which you really have to know in order to make predictive models which operate at the micrometer scale to the global scale. Oxygen concentration we know very well, we can measure quite well. Organic carbon flux to the sediments we know reasonable, because there's still issues that what is coming from the water column, what people predict from export models, is far too low at many places in the ocean to reproduce what we need to feed the sediment for the communities there. And then we have the bioturbation and the bioirrigation. Those are properties of the system. If you change the input, you get other animals and you get other bioturbation and bioirrigation things. So I would now go to the second most important factor. That's the reactivity, the lability of organic matter. That's a really important one. And there we have the issue that which is that it is not a single factor. Here you have the reactivity at on a log scale, and also the observational time window, also on a log scale. And you see that over multi-log scales, we see a very nice correlation between the reactivity of the organic matter, which you can detect, and the time scale you're looking at. So if you consider this plot and you start with freshly produced organic matter into the blue in the photic zone, you going to settle in the deep ocean water column, you see already that your organic matter reactivity declines. If you then arrive at the sediment in the bioturbation zone in the green, you see that there is a further decline of your reactivity, and this goes on and on and on. And this then poses a problem, because basically we need something in our model which is a first order rate constant, but we don't have very good constraints on it, because basically it varies over 8 orders of magnitude. So we want to understand what are the causes, how can we explain this? And basically, after 25 years, we still do not know what's the real reason. There are many publications about it, but we don't really know. Nevertheless, I want to lead you a little bit in the direction of what we think is important. So the underlying idea is that there is selective utilization preservation of different organic compounds. So what you see is that the most labeled components are consumed first. Like what we have here with the beer, the ale beer is consumed faster than the other beer. So that's also happening with the microbes and the other organisms. They first go for the high quality food. As a consequence, you're leaving a more reactive pool of organics behind. Now, this is fully consistent with the preferential utilization principle from the microbial literature and the selective preservation of the organic geochemist. It can nicely explain the decrease in reactivity with time. As a scientist, you should not be happy if you have a concept which you need, a constant which you need for your model, which you have some mechanism behind it, but you cannot measure it. So one of the challenges which I did the first 10 years after my PhD thesis is trying to get a relationship between the first order rate constant and something which you can measure. In this case, it is using the organic matter composition in terms of amino acids to derive a certain index, which you can use as an independent measure, as an independent proxy for the first order rate constant. And this is basically how good as it is, or how worse as it is. We cannot get better. We have not really made improvement the last 20 years. That's a pity, because really we need some independent constraints on the most important factor in sediment biogeochemistry. So, is the problem solved? We know we can explain the first order futures. We can measure it with an organic proxy, so we can go to the lab, do the measurements, and have some independent estimate. I don't think it is solved. There is the issue of secondary production. If you talk with a geochemist or an organic geochemist, they don't care anything about secondary production. Secondary production is what all heterotrophic organisms do if they want to grow, you call secondary production. And that's entirely ignored by the organic geochemistry world. Spatial distribution, it really matters how your organic matter is distributed, environmental conditions, oxygen. There are entire sessions here about the effect of oxygen on biogeochemical processes and the identity of the organisms, whether they're animals or microbes. Does it really matter? We don't know. So I want to go to a few of those points now. So one of the things which is perplexing is if we look at secondary production. What we did here is we added 13 C-labeled glucose and 15 N-labeled ammonium to an anoxic sediment and just let it go for 1.5 years, seeing what happened with the tracer. We traced the 13 C added into individual fatty acids, into individual amino acids, individual carbohydrates. And what you saw is within one day, there is a very rapid growth of the bacteria, the tracer is incorporated, and then the tracer remains in the sediment. It was not disappearing. And then you can say, okay, the bacteria just consumed the tracer and nothing happened afterwards. That was not the case because the sediment kept on consuming oxygen, so the bacteria kept on growing. And you see that there is a very long retention of this secondary produced organic matter. The other thing is that after a week, we had a large part of our organic matter we could not identify. It could mean that I'm a very poor organic geochemist, that I have no capabilities to do that, but that's what we all have. The issue is that whether you look at dissolved organic matter or particulate organic matter, whether you do it in lakes, whether you do it in rivers, you do it in the ocean, we usually come not further than about 30% of the organic matter. We know what it is, and 70% is uncharacterizable. Yet, organisms consume 99% of the organic matter. So in one way or another, the microbes and animals, they can process organic matter, which we as chemists cannot take apart and put into machines so that we can get some information out of it, which gives some clues to the nature of the compounds. So what is the emerging picture of organic matter processing in sediment? We have a big box of sedimentary organic matter, for 3/4 of which we do not know what it is. We think it is mainly proteins, but there are different views about this. A very small fraction we know what it is, that's the fresh fraction, that's the phytodetritus, which is consumed by the animals and microbes. Then they have secondary production, they produce biomass. That remaining organic matter and the biomass are again consumed by microbes, producing again modified organic matter. And if you do that a couple of times, you end up with an organic matter pool, which contains a very little amount of the original organic matter, a large pool of things we do not know what it is, and a lot of bacterial reprocessing material. And this is the emerging picture of the last few years. And here we have a few questions. Does bacterial-derived organic matter contribute significantly to sedimentary organic matter? If I would ask the question to somebody studying proteins, the person would probably say yes. If I would ask the very same question to the top lipid people, they would probably say no. So it is really the analytical window, the things which we see to our chemical classes, what will be the answer on this question. And the other thing is, can we quantify this conceptual view? Because you can have very nice concepts, but in the end, at least I always want to quantify things in order to see whether it really can explain the things what we see. So this was about secondary production. The other thing is that often when you have biogeochemistry, people say the biology is just microbiology. But there is more. There's also animals and higher plants. And one of the things which surprised me as being trained in chemistry and geology, if you look at competition, almost all papers in ecology are about competition among organisms which are very much alike. Competition between the different kingdoms, between the domains of life, is hardly studied. That's something which is not a topic you address. And I've done quite a lot of experiments with this, and this is a very simple experiment. What we did, we added a certain amount of 13 C-labeled phytodetritus In one set of experiments, we concentrated in the very surface layer. In another set of experiments, we mixed it all through the sediment column. The amount is the same, the quality is the same. And what we saw is that an animal, this time a worm, the NEOES dominated carbon processing if it was all in the top layer, and bacteria dominated when it was all mixed, when it was all diluted to the core. And what that means is that if organic matter is highly concentrated, animals go for it, and then they move around the sediment and stimulate their competitors, the bacteria. And this inspired me to have a look at what are the animal microbe interaction in the pelagic versus the benthic. So most of you are probably familiar with the pelagic microbial loop. The concept exists for 40, 50 years now, where you have the classical food web from phytoplankton to animals, and that's in green in the picture, and then you have the microbial loop where part of the organic matter is released as dissolved organic carbon by the phytoplankton, goes to microbes, and the microbes are consumed by the animals, and you have the microbial loop. Part of the microbes also die because of viruses, and that then is returned in DOC and it turns around. And basically what you have is that in the pelagic, that microbes support the animals. In the benthic, it's completely the other way around. In the benthic, we have phytodetritus is consumed by the animals and by the bacteria. And the bacteria, they go again in such a loop from viral lysis, release of dissolved organic carbon, taken up again by the microbes. And this is basically a dead-end loop because there is very little transfer from the microbes to the animals. The grazing on bacteria is very low. Most of the bacteria, they die because of viral lysis. And it is essential that the animals shuffle the sediment around to bring the labeled substrate to the bacteria, because bacteria are dead. They can never get this fresh organic matter arriving 10 centimeters above them. However, do they come to get it? They need the animals for that. So, the Hutchison Award. So I had a look at why that committee and why my colleagues thought I would be a good candidate for it. So, Hutchison, if I go to the wiki, because on Wikipedia everything is true. So he was really a pioneer of systems ecology. So he links physics, chemistry, and biology of lakes. And one of the things he also did, he wanted to understand the distribution of animals in lakes. And basically what he said, you have to understand the physics and chemistry of lakes besides the biology to predict what's going to happen with the animals. So in the seafloor chemistry, you have to understand the role of animals in order to predict the physics, the chemistry, and the microbes, because biological transport is orders of magnitude more important for moving organisms, particles around in sediments than physical transport. So animals and sediments are the transporters. They are the ecosystem engineer. They transport the organic matter, which stimulate the bacteria. They create 3D complex time variable oxygen fields. And so you really have to resolve the animals in order to advance our understanding of sediment biogeochemistry. But there is a problem there. In all our models, we don't include the animals as such. The energy required for moving sediment around, for living, to make up your secondary production, etc., is not included in the models. So another thing I saw when I went to the wiki is that he was the first to use radioisotopes as tracers in field experiments. And that's, I didn't know that before I went to read this. And I'm now going to show you some of my work I did with the use of 13C and 15N, so stable isotopes, in situ tracer addition studies. I've done lots of them in all the way from freshwater system to deep sea systems. And I'm going to show a result for two types of studies, the processing of fresh phytodetritus and the functioning of corals and sponges in the ocean. So we go back to our seafloor ecosystem. After 15 years at an ecological institute, I finally understood that my view from geosciences was too biased, so I don't make it a black box. And this time I add the 13C, and I'm going to trace the 13C in all the organisms which we could follow. So that means if you want to follow the microbes, you have to use compound-specific isotope techniques because you cannot physically separate them. So we did this, and these are the results. I did with some other groups, we made a compilation, and what you see is that respiration often dominates, in particular in the deep sea. That's the respiration is the white part of all those pie diagrams, which it should, otherwise the geochemists would have been problems with the ecologists much earlier about this, because the geochemists say only respiration matters, the rest doesn't. But if you go into coastal system, you see that bacterial assimilation, macrofaunal assimilation, or even forum uptake accounts for 25% in general. And of course, as always with biology, you have some deviation from the general pattern. And we also have quite some places where respiration is not the largest sink on the short term. No, it can be even the animals which are the most important, like the Pakistan margin or the Loch Etive. And you also can have places where bacterial uptake is much more important than the respiration. And for reasons not very well known, this is the case. So what? Why should you be interested in whether animals or bacteria are processing organic matter? So one of the reasons could be that you have an impact on the composition of the organic matter being buried. So we studied that. We did detailed laboratory studies looking at amino acid and carbohydrate and the fatty acid composition of systems with and without animals, but all with bacteria. And the basic conclusion is there are very tiny differences. It will hardly be possible to ever disentangle that if you don't use deliberate tracer experiment. Okay, so we make our system a little bit more complex. We're going now to the coal ecosystem, meaning that we're looking at ecosystems which are above the seafloor. And we're going to look at both at tropical corals, which are basically in the sunlit layer. They're living in nutrient-poor conditions, yet they are very productive and highly biodiverse. And we're going to look at cold water corals, which live in the dark, usually in the cold, and they depend on the organic resources raining down. So they are really organic resources depleted. In the figure you see in red, you see the tropical corals. In blue, you see the cold water corals, which are really extensive. And they probably would be much more extensive on this map if all countries would have resources to explore them, because you basically see they are along the US, the New Zealand, and the European coast. This just reflects where they do this type of research. So one of the issues, if you're looking at a tropical reef, is that primary producers, they fix a lot of organic carbon, about 300 to 600 gram carbon per square meter per year. And 50% is released as dissolved organic matter. Now, we all have learned that dissolved organic matter should be consumed by microbes. And people have been studying the microbial loop on coral reefs and saw that it's about 5 to 50 grams, which can account for it. What is happening with the rest of the organic carbon, dissolved organic carbon? So we thought it would be the sponges. Sponges are important, are really abundant in those coral ecosystems. They have been reported to consume dissolved organic matter, and they divide very rapidly. They are dividing as fast as most bacteria, even faster. And what we question is, if sponges consume dissolved organic matter, they divide rapidly, what is happening with the sponge detritus? So we proposed a sponge loop, which you can see on the right-hand side. Basically what it means, you have sponges consuming dissolved organic matter. They divide, they produce biomass, they produce detritus, and the detritus is then consumed by the animals. So what we did is we cultured algae. We extracted them to get complex dissolved organic matter labeled with 13C and 15N. We added them to the ecosystem, and we could see that the four sponges we tested were all labeled. We also saw when you let those sponges process that material that they produced detritus. And the next thing is that that detritus was subsequently used by all the animals which were in the system. So we have a complete sponge loop, meaning that there is dissolved organic matter which would otherwise be lost because the bacteria cannot all process them, is consumed by the sponges, is turned into detritus, which is then available for the higher organisms. So this was done, this part was done in separate laboratory experiments. So the next thing is that you want to do it in situ, because that's very important. You should always test your concept in situ. So The two colleagues, which I showed in the previous picture, they had a can labeled dissolved organic matter. They put some part of the coral reef under an enclosure. They injected the dissolved organic matter. They let it under the cover for a couple of hours, then they removed the cover, and then they followed the fate of the tracer. So, and this is the result of this in situ experiment. You can clearly see that in the gray part is that's the period when the incubation was going on. Then we have also indicated a little bit the pinkish part where most of the action is. You can see that sponges were rapidly labeled within a couple of hours. We saw that there was detritus production within 20 hours, and then there was transfer to the detritivores within 1 to 2 days. So we really could show in situ, by adding labeled dissolved organic matter, this was really happening in nature. So then you synthesize it into this picture, where you can see that primary producers release a lot of dissolved organic carbon. The microbes can only consume a fraction of it, and sponges really capture the majority, and that's then transferred to the fauna. This is a way to retain your resources in a system. So the sponges and the corals are really depending on each other. So this was done on a reef in the Dutch Caribbean area, so in one type of reef. So afterwards, we teamed up with a team of Germany, and we did the same thing in the Red Sea. That's on the left side where you see the warm water sponge loop. We could do the very same thing. We could show that it was not specific to this reef, but you could also reproduce in another system. And then the other thing is that we also found this sponge loop to be active in a cold water reef. So what we saw here is that corals excreted mucus that was dissolved organic matter was taken up by the sponges, and then the sponge produced detritus, which was then again used by the animals. So then I'm at the last part of my talk is about cold water corals. So Lophelias pertusa, what you see at the picture here, is a common reef which you find at many places in the dark ocean. It is living in a food-depleted environment. It's very versatile what it's eating. If you offer zooplankton, dead organic matter, phytoplankton, dissolved organic matter, it is going to consume it because it's living in a food-depleted environment. But we didn't know anything about the nitrogen cycling. So what we did is we were doing some tracer experiments to find out how does the nitrogen cycling work. So we added 15N labeled N2, and we waited for 24 hours, and what we saw is that a very large fraction of the 15N2 was fixed, and we could find it back in the tissue of the cold water coral. Also, a small fraction was released of ammonia, and another fraction was we could recover as nitrate. So we saw nitrogen fixation, ammonium regeneration, and nitrification. Now, we kept on going doing this. We saw that a lot of nitrogen cycling was going on. We basically could show complete nitrogen cycling in a cold water coral. So the organic nitrogen was excreted, it was reassimilated, there was nitrification, there was denitrification, so nitrate to N2, and there was the N2 fixation. So we could see a complete nitrogen cycle for organisms living at depth. That's quite surprising, because why should you fix nitrogen if you are resources depleted? This is an energy-consuming process. They do it, nevertheless. The other thing what is interesting, there was nitrification. So, as another thing, if you work with cold water corals or warm water corals, you also want to measure the calcification, so we did that. So we added 13C bicarbonate. You have to do it over a couple of days. We did that, and we saw that the 13C was not only going into the skeleton, meaning calcification, but also in the bulk organic tissue, meaning that there is GEMA autotrophy in those systems. Now, then we took that organic matter, we put it into our isotope ratio mass specs, and we looked at the lipids. And what we saw is that we could trace back the 13C in lots of lipids, including the ones which are characteristic for nitrophilous sulfur oxidizers, which are the ones in red. So, which makes sense because we saw that there was nitrification. We also looked at the incorporation of 13C and 15N into amino acids. And you can, that's the upper graph. You can clearly see that it was incorporated in all amino acids, trophic and non-trophic, essential one and non-essential one. So what does essential mean for an organism like this? So this really means that if you want to know what those organisms are eating, you cannot use the principle you are what you eat. Okay, I would like to thank, this is my last sheet, so Adina, you can... First, I would of course like to thank my wife for all the love and support, and my colleagues, former and present PhD student and postdoc, for all the work. So, and I worked with coastal biogeochemists, with Carlos Duarte and Jean-Pierre Cartusso, on bioturbation theory with Bernie Boudreau and Philip Meisman, organic geochemistry with Jaapsen en Damstee and Stefan Schouten, and my scientific father is the late Carlo Hype, which really taught me about biology, so that I, as a geochemist, should really think about the organisms. Thank you.